Hachette Audio presents Ride or Die, a feminist manifesto for the well-being of Black women. Written by Shanita Hubbard. Read by Tovah Ott. The love expressed between women is particular and powerful because we have had to love in order to live. Love has been our survival. Audre Lorde. Introduction. An Ode to Black Women. Honey, Sadie Oliver's seven daughters are not to be played with. My nanny raised the women who showed me that unconditional support and love could give a person wings. I was never afraid to fall when I took a leap because I knew the Black women in my life would swoop in and use every resource they had to ensure I stayed in flight. I grew up surrounded by Black women who led families, nurtured communities, and raised some of the most brilliant people I've ever met. My courage came from knowing that they were my supporters. I knew the Black women in my life were my superpower when I was 22 years old and had an anxiety attack while I was traveling. During my last year of graduate school, I decided to enroll in a study abroad program. The program required me to live with a Spanish-speaking host family in a small town located just outside of Madrid, Spain. Prior to that, I had only traveled domestically with friends or family. Traveling with family felt safest because I was literally moving around with my foundation. In 1979, the year I was born, my family started annual family reunions. My aunts and grandmother birthed these highly organized trips for hundreds of people. They didn't have the privilege of our technology to make it more efficient. There were no mass emails. There were no Facebook pages to dispense information on hotels and activities, no apps to send money for payments, or Zoom links to have family meetings to discuss the logistics. It was just a handful of Black women coordinating in different states by sending letters in the mail and making phone calls to make sure the family connections and love for each other remained fully intact, despite our geographical distance. Every summer, my grandmother and aunts would charter a 50-person passenger van, and my family from all parts of New York would meet in Yonkers so we could ride together to visit our family in North Carolina for the weekend. The whole bus would smell like fried chicken. All the kids were high on sugar, and our laughter bounced off the walls of the bus. We knew better than to run around. My cousins, brothers, and I would all cram together in a few rows and trade secrets, jokes, and snacks for hours. I don't think any of us actually fell asleep. It's more like our bodies would eventually just crash when the sugar and dopamine highs ended. I'm sure the grown-ups were intoxicated on more than sugar and happiness. I'm sure there were a few sips of pink champagne for my mom and aunties, and a little Colt 45 for my uncles. When I went back to grab more food or snacks, the joy from my older relatives was almost palpable. I didn't realize this at the time, but those annual family reunions shaped core pieces of who I am. Thanks to my family, I grew up knowing that Black women have the ingenuity, love, tenacity, and commitment to always show up for those we love. This deep-rooted understanding was my focal point as I centered myself on the flight to Spain when I was 22. I decided to travel alone rather than with the group of grad students who were leaving from the States because the flight they selected was too expensive for me. This meant I left the United States for the first time armed with faith, hood Spanglish, the address from my host family, and $1,500 from my student refund check. I started to think about these details on the flight. In Yonkers, my broken Spanish mixed with English worked well, but I knew it wouldn't get me far in Spain. I thought about how the European exchange rate would ensure that my little budget wouldn't last long once I arrived. It was 2002, so my plan to go from the airport to my host family's house didn't include Google Maps. I would have to rely on the local taxi drivers. Suddenly, things started to feel shaky. What the hell had I gotten myself into? This was a shitty plan. You're not gonna make it, and this isn't safe. My sweaty grip clung to the armrest, and it felt like there was a rubber band tightening around my lungs. The harder I tried to breathe, the tighter it got. I started to gasp. I felt like my heart was beating loud enough for the entire flight to hear. Tears escaped my tightly sealed eyelids. I peeled my sweaty shirt off. The air-conditioned plane felt like a freezer as I sat in my wet tank top. "Are you okay?" The white guy in the window seat to my left whispered to me. "Honey, should I get you some help?" The white woman sitting to my right asked. I couldn't open my eyes, but I could feel them staring at me. In the middle seat, I felt trapped by them. I shook my head no. I didn't understand what was happening, so I had no clue what help would even look like. As the rubber band around my lungs tightened, I allowed myself to sink into my fears and imagine how my terrifying fictitious scenarios could possibly play out. If my money runs out, I'll call my mom or aunts. If I get mugged at the airport on the way to my host family's house, I'll call my mom collect if I have to. If I don't feel safe with my host family, I'll grab my bags, find a payphone, and call my mom and aunts, and they will pull their money and get me on the first flight out of there. No matter how far-fetched or extreme I allowed my thoughts to go, they always landed on the inevitable. The black women in my life would protect me. The more I settled into that thought, the calmer I became. My breathing became effortless. My heartbeat normalized, and I felt safe enough to open my eyes. 20 years later, and the reality that black women will always show up for me still allows me to breathe. Whether that fear is stemming from leaving the country for 3 months or publishing my first book, I know with complete certainty that I am fully supported in life. I am who I am because of other black women, so I wrote this book to focus on us and our well-being. When I was younger, I used to read Susan Taylor's monthly column in Essence. She wrote about the inner lives of black women in a way that fed my soul. Since then, I dreamed of writing a book that would make black women feel seen. Ride or Die is a conversation starter for black women about contemporary topics that are essential for the world we live in today. A world where hip-hop is now the dominant musical genre and a global phenomenon. I grew up a hip-hop head, and artists like Nas, Jay-Z, The Notorious B.I.G., and Kiss were my writing inspirations. All writers love good storytelling and strong wordplay. These dudes use their words to skillfully craft vignettes about the lives of black men in our communities. They masterfully pull listeners into their stories and leave us feeling a deeper connection to the world. But the older I got, the more I started to realize that, far too often, the lives of black women were either reduced, misrepresented, or missing altogether from hip-hop. I can no longer hear One Love by Nas without thinking about the various ways his story about incarceration neglected the unique perspectives of black women. How has the missing narrative about black women's lives shaped my perspective as a black woman? I wrote these pages to speak to areas of black women's inner lives and experiences that hip-hop has yet to reach, and to do what generations of black women have done for me. Give me wings. 1. Ride or Die. We struggle together with black men against racism, while we also struggle with black men about sexism. The Cumbahee River Collective Statement. When the song Ride or Die, Bitch by The Lox was released in 1999, it became a guide for the type of woman I wanted to be. I was 21 years old, and this song was both an anthem in hip-hop and a personal roadmap. I wanted to be seen as a ride or die chick in the most romantic way. I wanted to be the Bonnie to a Clyde, a beautiful woman who was happily in an us-against-the-world relationship. She was celebrated and highly valued in the music that I loved the most, hip-hop. She was renowned for the sacrifices she made for her partner at almost any cost to herself. She was valued for her love and loyalty through the labor of it all. The ride-or-die chick is synonymous with some of our foremothers who love our families deeply, but never learn the delicate balance of loving others while protecting their own emotional needs. They taught us how to keep our family close, how to preserve family traditions, and how to raise brilliant Black girls who will grow to be amazing Black women. She is the person fully willing to do all the heavy lifting for those she loves. She is also the one who sacrificed pieces of herself for her family, like planning all the family events and arriving first and leaving last.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.